Yeah, so I think welcoming all of you, and particularly the two guests we have today, Professor Daniel and Professor Indrani. We will start this session of reading class. The reading class is a forum where we talk about ideas which are quite interdisciplinary, and also to deal with complex issues and needs an engagement which is perhaps needs much more time and patience, and of course some expertise as well. So today's speaker is Dr. Shankar Rajaraman. He is a medical doctor to begin with, and but he also heals people's minds. So he has a degree in psychiatry as well, and he has devoted, I guess, almost all of this life and maybe many previous lives also in translating textbooks, because that is his first love. He loves to translate. He's a scholar in Sanskrit, and also he loves to write poetry. He is a great blessing to this institute to have a person like him who has expertise in multiple fields, and then all of us know he's one of the most humble souls in NIAS, I would say a repository of wisdom. So today he's speaking on intratextuality in Sanskrit works, and because this forum has a particular format of not just a full lecture but a kind of a lecture which is restricted to maximum of 30 minutes and the rest 30 minutes for discussion, doctor has said that he will speak only for 30 minutes and then the rest 30 minutes we'll have discussion. So we will have total of 1 hour, so I request your patience to stay for 1 hour, and I will request myself also to stay for 60 minutes. So doctor.
Good evening to all of you, and thank you ma'am for the introduction. My topic is titled Intratextuality in Sanskrit Works. So let me begin with what I understand by intratextuality in my talk. So when I say text here, I am confining in this talk to historical written texts in Sanskrit. And by intratextuality, I mean a text as being self-bound and complete in itself, and allowing the text to guide us in understanding it without much necessity of invoking anything extraneous to it. And how can a text be a guide if it is read deeply, and what can deep reading help? It can help make sense of the text as a whole, make sense of specific textual portions, and identify corrupted text, free it of its corruption, and even recreate it in its original form. And I give examples for this as I traverse through my talk. Let me begin with the last point, identifying a corrupted text, freeing it of its corruption, and even recreating it in its original form first. So I take text from three different disciplines. One from Kavya, which is poetry, then from Shastra, which is technical writing, and then from Purana, which is which could be translated as mythological lore. For Kavya, I take this text called as Raghavendra Vijaya, which is written in, it's a Mahakavya. Mahakavya is a, it's translated as an epic poem. It's a large poem with chapters that are called as cantos or sargas, and the sargas can be anywhere between 8 to 50, and this Raghavendra Vijaya has 10 cantos or sargas and overall 577 verses. It is written by Narayanacharya, who belongs to the 17th century. The work is basically on the life of the pontiff, the Dvaita pontiff Raghavendra, whom many of you must have heard. The text has three commentaries, but this particular verse which I choose has only one commentary. The remaining two commentaries are not there for this particular verse. And this verse is the penultimate verse of the entire poem. So it is the 576th verse. Let me read out the verse. Santam Shri Ramana Priyam Yativaram Vyasasya Bhave Bhrisham Durvaramita Mai Bhikshuti Mire Parvastha Chandram Bhuvi Satsanga Stutam Ishtadakshitiruham Vandaru Viprashriyam Tam Natva Sakalo Duruha Sudrisham Samyati Vidyadikam. This is the verse that is present, that is published now in the book. And I have translated it as follows. Having bowed down to the greatest of sages, beloved of Vishnu, strongly established in the words of Vyasa, full moon to the dense darkness of Mayavadins, by Mayavadins is meant the Advaitins, praised by the virtuous, wish-shielding tree that grants the desires of wise devotees, every being shall attain unconceivable knowledge and the like. Now, this is the page from the published book. The book is published by Sri Guru Sarvabhauma Samshodhana Mandiram Mantralayam, where the Vrindavana of this particular pontiff is present, and it is edited by a group of scholars. This, the lower picture is the commentary on that particular verse, the only one available commentary on that verse. Now, when I read this verse in the context of the other verses in the same poem, I felt that this verse was something different when compared to the other verses. Why? Because there was a lack of lucidity in this verse as compared to the other verses. It's not very difficult to understand, but there is a particular characteristic in poetry called as prasada, which is lucidity, and that lucidity was missing in this verse. And to understand what lucidity is, you should have read lot of Sanskrit verses to get an idea of what is a lucid verse and what is not a lucid verse. And here I suspected that there was lack of lucidity, and this being the penultimate verse, the penultimate verse had to be very strikingly poetic in nature, have very beautiful imagery, or at least be bombastic. And all these qualities were missing in this particular verse. There was not very striking poetry in this verse. So these two features led me to think that there was something different with this particular verse. So the first question that came to my mind was, is there some other constraint other than the poem that is working here? And when you say constraint, the first thing that strikes to your mind is something called as Chitrakavya, which is a special type of poetry, a poetry that is written with keeping lot of constraints in mind. And Chitrakavya is not a single entity, but it has hundreds of subtypes. And just by looking at a verse, it might be difficult to say what subtype of Chitrakavya is present in that particular verse. And why are constraints imposed by the poet? The constraints are imposed by the poet on himself to evoke wonder. This is not unlike a rope walker. So a rope walker imposes constraint on himself. He walks on the rope so as to evoke wonder in the audience. And poets also impose constraints on themselves to evoke wonder in the reader. But then there is lack of lucidity when you try to put constraints on yourself. Just as when you walk on the rope, it is not a normal walk, the walk seems to be very strained. In the same way, when you have constraints in poetry, poetry also loses some of its lucidity. So that is the reason why there is no lucidity in this verse. Probably there is a Chitrakavya here, there is a constrained poetry here. But the commentary itself does not identify that there is a constraint here. And again, if I suspected that there was indeed a constraint here, what subtype of Chitrakavya would it be? Because there are hundreds of Chitrakavya subtypes, and what constraint is working here? Then the next thing that came to my mind was, there are specific type of constraints that are possible in specific type of meters. You all must have heard of meters, and to give a easy understanding of what a meter is, the meters are usually based on the number of syllables in each line of a verse. So if you have 8 syllables in a line, such a meter is called Anushtup. So if you have say 19 syllables in a line, that is called a Shardula Vikridita, and this verse is in Shardula Vikridita meter. So there is certain constraints are possible only if the verse is composed in Shardula Vikridita meter. So here there are 19 syllables in the first line and also in the subsequent lines. So if you count the number of syllables, you have 19. And when I say a syllable is a consonant plus a vowel, or sometimes two consonants plus a vowel. For example, in Shri, you have Sh, R, and those are the consonants, and E is the vowel. Sometimes mostly there is one consonant and a single vowel. So the commonest subtype of constrained poetry with 19 syllables in the line is something called as chakrabandha or a wheel pattern. But then wheel pattern itself can be of different types. So the easiest subtype of a chakrabandha is one in which the middle syllable of each line is the same. So if I have to show it, there are 19 syllables in each line, and so the simplest form of chakrabandha would be you have a hub of the wheel and these are the spokes. So you would have 9 letters here, 9 letters here. So this would be the first line, this would be the second line. Each Sanskrit verse has 4 lines. This would be the third line and this would be the fourth line. And each the central letter of each line would be the same, and that would form the hub of the wheel. So you would have 9 here, 9 here of the first line, 9 syllables, 9 syllables of the second line, 9 syllables, 9 syllables of the third line, and 9 syllables, 9 syllables of the fourth line. And the tenth syllable of each line would be the same, and that would form the hub. So next, I had to find out if in this given verse, the central syllable of each line is the same. So when I wrote them in this manner and checked for the central letter, in each of these three lines, we find that the central letter is the same, which is Ti. However, it is not the same in the fourth line. The fourth line, the central letter of the fourth line is Su and not Ti. So this is not the easiest type of chakrabandha, but a more complicated type of chakrabandha. So, and that complicated type of chakrabandha is one where the first three lines form the spoke and the last line forms the rim of the wheel. So this is an example of a chakrabandha written in that manner. So it has 6 spokes and the last line forms the rim of that wheel. So this is from the 7th century work Shishupalavada by Magha, and as you can see, the first three lines, these are the first three lines. This is the first line, this is the second line, and this is the third line, and the fourth line starts from here and ends here, and that forms the rim of the wheel, and the central letter of each of these lines is the same, which is Ra. Now if it has to be a 6-spoked wheel pattern, the following letters must match. So the first letter of the first line and the fourth letter of the fourth line should match. The 19th letter of the first line and the 13th letter of the fourth line should match. The first letter of the first line and the 7th letter of the fourth line should match. The 19th letter of the second line and the 16th letter of the fourth line should match. And the 19th letter of the third line, the first letter of the second fourth line, and the 19th letter of the fourth line should all match. So is there such a match in this particular verse was what I had to find out next. So when I wrote them in this manner, I found out that there is indeed a match at least in 4 of these pairs. So you have Sa and Sa matching, which had to match, and then you have V and V matching, then you have Du and Du matching, the T are anyhow matching. However, I found out that there were other pairs of letters or other groups of letters which didn't match. So 19 and 13 had to match, but you have Sham here and Sam here, and then these three had to match, but then you have Yam, Tam and Kam here, and again these two had to match, but you have Sa in one place and Su in another place. So the next question is, which of, if I have to deal with the non-matching blocks, how do I match them? So should I, it is possible that I have Sham here or Sam here to match. In the same way, if I had to match Sa and Su, should both Sa and Su be changed to only Sa or only su. And again yam, tam and kam, should I change them into all into yam, all into tam or all into kam? So that was the next choice I had to make, and I figured out what had to be there based on my knowledge of Sanskrit. So for example, if I had su here, I would get the reading sutsanga, which doesn't make any meaning. So if I have sa there, then I have satsanga, and if I have sa here, I have sadrisham, which is also a meaningful word. So based on this, I could reconstruct the verse in this manner. So, and prove that the verse that has been published is not the poet's verse, but this is the poet's verse actually. However, there is also an icing on the cake. So talented poets, what do they do is they often hide their name or text related information when they compose a six spoke wheel pattern. So is there such a information that is hidden within this verse itself? And there was indeed this information that was hidden. So when I read these groups of letters together, you have Shri Raga Vendram Pranamami Sarvada, so which means I eternally bow down to the Pontiff Raghavendra. And keeping all these changes in mind, the wheel pattern that emerges is like this. So you have the three lines intersecting at the hub, which is the same letter for all the three lines, which is P, and then you begin from and the fourth line forms the hub. And when you read these letters, Shri Raghavendram Pranamami Sarvada, so it forms one of the circumferences of those wheels. So coming to intratextuality within Shastra, I choose the text Abhinav Bharati and Bharata's Natya Shastra. Abhinav Bharati is the it changes slightly, and anyhow, the because there are a lot of constraints, the meaning is not very important or very poetic, but there is a small change in the meaning. So here I choose the text Abhinav Gupta's Abhinav Bharati, which is a commentary on Bharata's Natya Shastra. There is a difficult to understand phrase in Abhinav Gupta's commentary, and that phrase is Dalasthaniyaha Vibhavaha. So Vibhava refers to antecedent stimulus for a particular mental state, and in one place Abhinav Gupta says Vibhavas take this place of Dalas. Dala, what is Dala will be discussed further. So this is a difficult to understand phrase and has been usually translated, the word Dala has usually been translated by many people as petals. I will not go into the details of this is a particular interpretation of the Rasa Sutra given by the Sankhya philosophers. I will not go into the details of what the Sankhya philosophers interpret about the Rasa Sutra. I shall only concentrate on this particular phrase here. Noli translates this phrase as takes the place of petals. So in this combination, the determinants take the place of petals, and the consequence and the transitory mental states do the duty for what garnishes it. So what garnishes it is not understandable, because he is not talking about any cooking or etc. It's not about a particular stuff to be eaten that needs to be garnished. But then he anyhow translates the word samskaraka as what garnishes it. And Kangle is unsure about it, but he takes it as limb. So he has Dalasthaniyaha Vibhavaha Samskaraka Anubhava Vyavicharinaha Ya Vachanacha Nishchit Artha Sangne Kathinahe Dal Manve Paruli. I am not conversant with Marathi, but anyhow, he uses the word Paruli, which means a petal. So both of them take it to be petal, but then Bharata elsewhere gives the metaphor of cooking to explain the process by which rasa is evoked in the audience. And given the word dala is quickly followed by the word samskaraka, which refers to what garnishes, and Noli correctly takes it as a substance that garnishes. It's obvious that dala also must be a metaphor that is borrowed from the verb.
May I ask that you translate that line? You don't have to go into details of it. You just chose the
particular, yeah.
Could you just translate the line?
Oh, that the Marathi line, is it?
No,
the Sanskrit line. Okay, yeah. Yeah, the line is tasyam cha samagriyam, in that combination, dalasthaniyaha vibhavaha. The vibhavas take the place of dala. And what dala is the discussion, is what is being discussed. Samskarakaha anubhava vyabhicharinaha. Anubhavas and vyabhichari bhavas take the role of samskara, which means things that garnish. Sthayinastu tat samagri janya antara sukha dukkha svabhava iti. And what are sthayis? Sthayis are the pleasure, are referred to pleasure and displeasure that is caused by that combination. So the rasa sutra of Bharata is basically vibhava anubhava vyabhichari sayoga rasa nishpattihi. So rasa, which is aesthetic pleasure, that is created, aesthetic pleasure is created when vibhava, anubhava and vyabhichari bhava come together. And Bharata gives the example of cooking to explain what this rasa sutra is. Just like various ingredients come together and bring about taste in us, so in the same way, vibhava, anubhava and vyabhichari bhava together come together and create aesthetic pleasure in the audience. So because the metaphor relates to cooking, dala is also possibly a word that refers to cooking. And in fact, dala is also the word dal is basically taken from the word, is derived from the word, Sanskrit word dala. And as you can see, dalahan, the Sanskrit origin of this word, of this Hindi word, is daladhanya, and vahan jiski dal banti hai. So this basically, the word dala here basically refers to not to petals, because petals don't have anything, cannot be part of a metaphor that relates to cooking, but dal can. So that is the with respect to intratextuality within a text, within a portion of the text. Here I discuss intratextuality that helps to understand a text as a whole. And what I choose is the Bhagavata Purana, which has been ascribed to Vyasa. Bhagavata Purana, which is one of the 18 Puranas, an important Purana, has an entire chapter that is devoted to the elaboration of Sankhya philosophy. And this is present in its first skandha itself. So it is divided into chapters called as skandhas. Bhagavata Purana has several skandhas. And the first skandha itself has an entire chapter devoted to Sankhya philosophy, where Kapila, the sage Kapila, expounds the tenets of Sankhya philosophy to his mother Devahuti. And why should this be present in a Puranic text? And my hypothesis is that Sankhya philosophy has been introduced in the very beginning of Bhagavata Purana, because it is in the backdrop of Sankhya philosophy that events that have been narrated in the Purana must be understood. And I have thought about several episodes where this Sankhya philosophy can be employed to understand events, but I choose to delineate only two episodes here. One is the Govardhana episode and the other is the episode of Jarasandha. So I will not go into the details, but then to make it simpler, here Krishna coincides with the enlightened individual who has an excess of sattva guna, and the Govardhana hill that he holds in his hand is akin to the intellect. And you must understand that intellect in Sankhya philosophy is an evolute of matter, and therefore intellect is akin to grossest of matter, and the grossest of matter we could think of is also a mountain, because it's full of stones and rocks. So it is grossest of matter. And then the sense organs here are akin to the cows there. And why? Also, I show how dictionary also gives one of the meanings for the word go as senses. So you have an organ of sense here for the word go. So go has several, the word go has several meanings, and one of the meaning is an organ of sense, and also akin to sense, because just as cows graze in the meadows, the sense organs also graze their objects, sensory objects. And the rain and the flood that is described in that episode, I link it to sensory overload. And the and Indra there is akin to, if there are sensory objects there in the world, there is also a regulating principle for those objects. And I equate Indra with the regulating principle of the material world. So what does an enlightened individual do is to use his intellect to guard his sense organs. And why should their sense organs be guarded? Because the sense organs are in the grip of a sensory overload. Just as the entire Gokula translates to an aggregate of cows, and also it is the hamlet where Krishna lived, is in the grip of the flood. Just as the sense organs are in the grip of their sensory overload. So also it must be understood that Indra here is, it's significant because Indra is also the presiding deity of the Indriyas, of the sense organs. So the word Indriya itself is derived from the word Indra. And this is the Jarasandha episode, where Jarasandha was born in two pieces. The child was born in two pieces, and the demoness Jara brought the two pieces together, and then the child sprang to life. And finally, Bhima had to kill Jarasandha by splitting him open into two pieces and throwing the pieces in opposite directions so they cannot come and join together. So, matter, Prakriti, brings together the elements and fashions a body out of it. To escape Prakriti requires many lifetimes, and when there is freedom from Prakriti, there is no longer an embodied existence. So, in this particular episode from Bhagavata, the demoness Jara is Prakriti. And also note, the word Jara means old age, and old age goes with changing, and old age is associated with changing and aging, which are also properties of Prakriti or matter. And Jarasandha is what is brought together by Jara or Prakriti, which is the embodied lower self. And who is Krishna? Krishna is the evolved being who has an excess of sattva, who must free himself from his embodied lower self. So, in fact, the higher self is fighting with the lower self in a way. The sattvic individual wants to free himself of his lower self, and therefore, the lower self can be conceived as an enemy of the higher self. So, Jarasandha can be conceived as an enemy of Krishna, because just as the lower self is an enemy of the higher self, because the lower self binds the higher self and prevents it from liberation. Bhima is the evolved beings, or in this case Krishna's intellect. Also note here that it is on the clue of Krishna that Bhima splits open Jarasandha's body and throws the pieces back to back so they don't unite. So a wise individual, which is Krishna, uses his intellect, which is Bhima, to free himself or herself from his or her lower self, which is Jarasandha. And there are multiple failed attempts by Bhima in this episode, which refers to multiple lifetimes across which the intellect is wrongly used, and therefore freedom from the body is not achieved. So, I conclude with this observation: surrendering to the text will reveal to you its deepest hidden secrets, and surrendering entails reading the text deeply, both in its form and sense. Thank you.
Intellect, you're talking, right? So, according to the assumption that intellect is actually made up of matter, right? So, and you also told that matter is also subjected to change its properties according to aging and all. So, for a enlightened person, will the intellect change due to this aging, and will it get affected so that he or she may take wrong decision.
So actually I am not saying that intellect changes with aging. So aging is just a metaphor for Prakriti. Just as aging brings about a change in the body, so does Prakriti also keep changing. So Prakriti is one of the important principles in Sankhya philosophy. So there are two principles in Sankhya philosophy, Purusha and Prakriti. The Purusha doesn't change, but the Prakriti keeps on changing. And one of the manifestations of Prakriti is the body. So body also keeps changing. The mind also is an evolute of Prakriti. So mind also is derived from Prakriti, and also mind also keeps on changing. So it is not that mind also changes with age, just as body also changes. But then these are part of Prakriti whose basic nature is to keep on changing. And that particular Rakshasi has been called as Jara, and I wanted to connect that Jara with the changing qualities of Prakriti. So I wanted to connect that name of that particular demoness with Prakriti, because I had to make a link between, to complete this metaphor, I had to make a link between that particular demoness Jara and the principle of Sankhya, which is Prakriti. And her name itself suggests that she could be Prakriti, because changing is quality of Prakriti, and changing in its most developed form is seen in old age. So, and that is why that particular Rakshasi has been called as Jara.
So, in the Govardhana episode, you made an observation which to me was very striking, and I didn't quite understand it. Namely, I have no problem with the analogy between the intellect, between Buddhi and mountain. But if I know my Sankhya at all, it would seem that intellect is the first evolute, it's Mahat, right? And then there are grosser and grosser evolutes that come out of that. But you describe the intellect as the grossest.
Means if it can, not the intellect as the grossest, but then mountain could be in a way a gross representation of Prakriti. We also see that there are repeated references to the earth to make it as an analogy of matter. For example, when Krishna swallows the earth, swallows a lump of earth. Or for example, when you have the story, in the story of Parashurama, the name of Parashurama's mother being Renuka, where Renu refers to dust. So all these things connected with earth, dust and mountain and lump of clay, etc., I feel are there to make connection with Prakriti. Okay. As an analogy.
So you don't really need it to be the grossest.
It is not the grossest, but then as a poetic analogy that has been used.
So in that Govardhan episode, right, I mean leading to that episode, I think the event is where Krishna asks these people not to give the oblations, right, not to give the yajna. Can that be considered as the tapas? Because when a yogi does tapas, he starves the sense organs, right? I mean, and then the sense organ revolts.
So, basically they are giving the havis,
right,
havis
right.
to Indra,
right?
Which means you are engaging your sense organs a lot.
Right, and so he asked them not to do
you
it.
You are pampering
right?
your sense organs, basically.
Right, right. So, once he asked them not to do it, only then the rain starts
yeah,
and...
Yeah.
Now, this penultimate verse you said, no? That, why is it the penultimate verse? What about the last verse? I mean, that is normal. That is
that last verse somehow is very normal.
Okay, okay. So but when you read it, so you are able to. I mean, it's quite amazing. You know, it's like, see, I have worked in cryptography. This is actually a classic case of what is called steganography. You know, so you embed some things in the in the message itself. You know, which helps you to discover.
Yeah.
So, but how do you get a sense of this? Like, you were able to see it based on the lucidity of it. That I think is striking to me. I mean.
Yeah. Also, because of my own. My own expertise in writing such poetry.
Okay.
So in fact, I also use this in my own life to hide a particular message.
Right.
In one of my
so the way
so
you,
in one of my works, Chitra Naishadam, somebody had suggested me about this publisher. And who would publish my work, and the person who suggested and the publisher were both friends when I started to write the poem.
Right.
But by the time I finished writing the poem, they had become enemies.
Okay.
And when I had to when I had to acknowledge people,
right,
the publisher told me that I shouldn't acknowledge this person.
Oh, okay, so you have to embed the.
But then what happened is I had to acknowledge this person.
Yeah.
So what I did is I composed my last verse of Chitranaishadam in praise of the publisher.
Okay.
And in that verse which praised the publisher, I hid the name of this his friend. So there was no, he could, means if I had done it in some other verse,
right,
the publisher
right.
could have taken away, means he could have wished not to.
So now he cannot
not
remove
to,
it.
Because it's on him.
Got it. So that's very, very clever. Yeah.
If he had removed his that verse, he would have removed his own praise also.
Right. No, because I was very impressed with the steganography, you know, that it's a classic cryptographic kind of principle. So, thank you.
Yeah. Our publisher also came to know, but he couldn't remove the verse. Yeah.
Shankar, I have a question on the back of Professor Nitin's question. To me, what you said about prasada, your lucidity, poor translation, but that seems kind of mysterious. So maybe you can describe it in some way using an example or two. Or
how would I say? It's something that is felt more.
I'll tell you why it is of interest to me, because there's also the expression chitta prasada. Right? Is there a connection?
So there's a prasada guna in prasada which is because of sattva guna. So there is a relationship between sattva guna and prasada. But then how that prasada, probably there is a chit means when a poet decides to compose a verse, there should also be some amount of chitta prasada in his mind that finally leads to prasada in his own writing. So I think there should be means at the time of conceiving an idea, poets may be very very blissful, but then when they need to put, it's after they conceive the idea that they actually find the words for conveying that idea and putting it in the form of a verse. But when they put it in the form of a verse also, they should maintain this particular sattva, excess of sattva that was there at the time of composing or conceiving of the idea. So when they are composing the verse also, I would say that when I compose a verse, I first find out if the verse is actually intelligible to me myself, and I don't want to cheat myself at that time. So I don't think that okay, this particular word is something which I cannot easily understand, but the readers might probably understand it. I don't think in that way. I have to be convinced myself that I understand what I write completely, so that the odd and without much difficulty. So prasada is where you, as soon as you read a particular verse, you are a person who knows Sanskrit, or at least or even people who know Indian languages with lot of Sanskrit in them should be able to make out those words, make out the meaning of those words.
Dr. Shankar, thanks as ever. I was just wondering whether these two lines have something cryptic inside them. You know, and I'm reading them again and again, and trying to understand what exactly do we mean by surrendering to the text. Because the only way you can surrender to the text is to have a mastery of the text through its language, its composition, and grammar, etc., etc., which you have.
That's what is said in that second line, that
yes.
surrendering
so
requires knowing the text both in its...
Yeah, so I was coming to that. So the second part, surrendering entails reading the text deeply, both in its form and sense. So when you say deep reading, can you ever do a deep reading? I mean, you can only have a deep experience, right? So I was just wondering, what exactly is the metaphor you have used in reading the text, such as depth? So what is that metaphor which connotes certain kind of depth
in
reading? Because usually depth is used to connote your experiences, which is also very interesting. And if what you say is right, and also getting back to what Dr. Nitin has said, it's amazing that certain like a bija, like a you know, like a very potent source of potency hidden in words, which actually kind of liberates you, and liberates you maybe not from just ignorance of a particular text or a language, but ignorance of the self itself, which I guess in many of this That is the intent, right? I mean, even bringing the idea of Prakriti, which you said, and so on. Yes, thank you.
So, let me take an example again from poetry itself, ma'am. So, because that is the province which I know a bit. So, and from my own experience of what deep reading is and when deep reading doesn't occur. So, lot of people whom I know, at least with respect to Sanskrit poetry, when they read a verse or when they read poetry, they think that poetry needs to give them an information. So they read the even a poetic verse, poetic work, as if they need to get some information from it, factual information from it. Or probably because I don't know of how people read in other languages. In English, I don't know whether people would concentrate on the words too much, to the extent of forgetting the sense of what is written. But in Sanskrit poetry, at least, you need to give equal importance to both word sense as well as the words that have been used.
The sense, you mean the meaning?
The shabda and the artha.
The image which is portrayed.
The artha. So, in certain words.
The image which is portrayed through meaning. Through meaning,
yeah. So, they need to give importance not just to that image or not just to the meaning, but also to the words that have been used there. And where words predominate sense and where sense predominates words. So there are also places where words become more important than sense. And there are places where sense...
How is that? Because if words are more important than the sense, is it serving a larger purpose, which is conveying something which is very more complex and multi-layered?
So poetry need not always convey something very deep or very multi-layered. So poetry can also be something appealing to the ear itself, just the ear, not to the mind. So when you have a verse like Swachandochaladachakachakoharachateetarambuchata, you know that it is the words that are predominating in this verse, not the meaning. So, but usually people, probably because they come to Sanskrit after having read works in other languages, where the words become of secondary importance and sense becomes more important, they don't give much importance to both.
And you talk about the vernacular language, and I mean maybe in Malayalam, since I read a little bit, where the image is also equally given equal importance just as the words, and the power of word is, I don't want to take any big poets, non-poets, I'll just take the example of Biba. I can't get away forgetting what she has written, very casually perhaps, which is, I don't know, people who know Malayalam, know here. ഒരു മഴയാവാൻ ആഗ്രഹിച്ച ഒരു മഴത്തുള്ളി ആയി പോയവൾ ഐ എം നോട്ട് അനലൈസിംഗ് ബട്ട് ദാറ്റ് ഇമേജ് സ്റ്റേസ് ഇൻ മീ അഗൈൻ ആൻഡ് ഐ തിങ്ക് ഐ ഹാവ് ടോൾഡ് യു ദിസ് ബിഫോർ റൈറ്റ് സംവൺ ബേസിക്കലി ദ മീനിംഗ് ഈസ് വൺ ഹു വാണ്ടഡ് ടു ബിക്കം റെയിൻ എ ടൊറൻഷ്യൽ റെയിൻ ബട്ട് ജസ്റ്റ് ബിക്കേം എ റെയിൻ ഡ്രോപ്പ് സോ യു നോ ദേർസ് എ ലോട്ട് ഓഫ് ലിബറേഷൻ ഇൻ ദാറ്റ് അറ്റ്ലീസ്റ്റ് ഐ ഫെൽറ്റ് യു നോ ദ പോയറ്റ് മസ്റ്റ് ബി എക്സ്പീരിയൻസിംഗ് ആൻഡ് ദ റീഡേഴ്സ്
So there are also verses where the meaning is more important,
yeah.
And there are good poets who combine both,
yes,
to an equal extent,
right.
To so it appeals even to the ear as well as to the heart.
I mean, we can debate on this. Maybe I'm wrong also. The word is more relating to Prakriti, and the meaning relates to something which is higher.
Or the aestheticians or the aestheticians would say that the word serves the purpose of the meaning.
So
even if you are using such figures of speech, figures of shabdalankaras, you need to use it in such a way as to enhance emotion that is conveyed through a verse. And Sri Kumar Menon sir gave me a from Pallava, image of Govardhana. However, I couldn't put it because it didn't have Indra there.
Okay.
This verse Swachandochala. We know that the poet has spent most of his energy in figuring out this assonance of cha repeating regularly. So when I translate it, I would probably try to imitate that particular structure in case the poet has given lot of importance to form, then I would try to replicate that form in my translation. If the poet has given lot of importance to the meaning, then I would try to replicate that. So I have also tried, like, for example, there is a verse called Tara Tara Tarai Re Tai Ruttaro Taro Torate Rutai ratartha tittiri rauti tire tire tarau tarau, which has only tha and ra, and I and another translate, co-translator Venetia, when we translated it using only four consonants in English. So we tried to replicate it to some extent, because if you just translate the meaning of that verse, it is not very poetic. And we know that the poet has spent more time in choosing only ta and ra, and that has to be somehow conveyed to the reader. It is not enough if we try to just translate the meaning of the verse. We need to here in this particular case, we need to translate even the form of the verse. So that we tried to some extent. So depending on what he has given importance to in the original verse, and even if you have to forego certain peripheral things, it is okay. But that central idea which the poet is having, which is his vivaksha, what he wants to try to convey, what is his intention, that has to be translated even in when you translate it into English.
So it seems like this kind of poetry in particular, where a lot of work is done to make sure that things match up exactly right and so on, this is a very, very deliberate kind of poetry. But then there is poetry that is not that way.
It's very spontaneous. Spontaneous. Not spontaneous, but then appears to be spontaneous at least.
I don't know. So I work on Tagore, as it happens. I also translate him. So there is much poetry there that, at least he claims, it came at the level of bhava. That's how he puts it. And only later was he able to make sense of, you know, at the level of the intellect, he was able to make sense of it. So in that sort of writing, and this happens in many languages, I suppose, to many, many different kinds of poets, and we know of Kubla Khan by Coleridge and so on. So in that sort of a case, how does this prasada work itself out? Because it's not as though there was prasada before and there's a causal relation between the prasada in the poet's mind and what appears on the paper. Right, the prasada somehow
immediately
appears. So, how do you theorize that?
Yeah, I feel when the sometimes the ideas just come as a flash also, but then to come as a flash, I think the poet keeps on meditating on a particular idea, and meditating on the overall context of the idea. And then within that context, there is a striking idea that suddenly comes up as a flash.
Can I say something?
Yeah.
When you were saying this suddenly coming as a flash, in my mind I was thinking of flash. But it's interesting to see, from a Vedantic point of view,
the light is already there. It is darkness which we are removing, right? So the it is not just the flash. Actually, you are surrounded by luminance. So much darkness is there. At some point, some darkness, a piece of, like when you cut the pizza, right? You just cut a slice. So a slice of darkness just gets removed from there.
But then
right?
I think
usually we think it the other way, that the light has to be brought. But actually, it is not the light has to be brought, but
darkness
just
has to be.
So it is not just the flash has come. It is actually the darkness has just
has
went
gone,
out.
Has gone.
I mean, just putting it metaphorically.
Yeah. But personally, what I do, I can only talk from my side, my own experience, is that suppose I need to write a verse on a particular episode from Krishna's life, on a particular very bounded idea from Krishna's life. But then, what I actually do is I don't think about that particular idea at all. I begin with much more from a much more broader canvas, and when I'm contemplating on that broader canvas, something that is striking within that broader canvas itself appears as a flash. So, but for that I need to be thinking about it for the whole day. Sometimes I'm thinking, it's always in the back of my mind when I'm traveling in the bus, in the auto, in the office also. I'm almost immersed in that particular context, and I don't know what that striking idea is actually. I'm only immersed in the particular context, but then I know that at some particular point of time, a striking idea comes, and then it is for me to work out that idea using prasada guna. Means it is not that I deliberately want prasada guna to come there. But the idea is basically, I have this idea, and am I able to put it in a way that I am first able to make sense of without cheating myself. So I think lot of people in their hurry to show their idea to others cheat themselves and not allow for that prasada guna to seep in. They think that they are yes, the idea is very striking, but then unless the idea is conveyed in appropriate words that is easily understandable to them, understandable to the reader, it doesn't serve the purpose. I think so you need to also have appropriate words that convey the idea in its fullest, and that happens when you first decide that you will not cheat yourself, you will not bring forth a verse.
In that whole experience, there is no you, I would say.
That I itself
it's kind of gone towards the periphery. That the center has enlarged so much. Right? I mean, the I is changed by the process.
Yeah, correct.
But I completely agree with you, but then I was also thinking, not only in poetry, at least when we have to write something which is very deep and perhaps which is so profound that you yourself wouldn't know how to articulate it, often it happens that we think about the periphery of that idea much more, though your intent is actually something else which is still not verbalized enough. But then the more you think about the periphery, at some point something comes up. What I'm saying in writing prose also, writing journal articles.
If I have to give an analogy of a case where there is no prasada guna, there is this particular art form called as avadhana. Have you heard of it? So where you need to compose extempore poetry. So you are given certain topics by a panel of people who themselves can compose poetry but who have composed this poetry in their house. And they ask you are the avadhani, and you are asked to compose a verse extemporaneously. And here, first of all, I was an avadhani earlier, but I have forsaken avadhana now, because there is first of all laws of independence, because you are given a topic by a panel of people, and then you need to compose it on the spot immediately. So there is always a lurking fear that you will not be able to compose the verse and be a laughing stock in front of the audience. So what people do is, they come up with verse. I have never seen an avadhani not coming up with a verse. But then the verse is so badly sculpted that the avadhani has to add extra material to it while explaining it to the audience. Everybody knows that the verse is not complete. The words have not been put properly. They are not conveying what the idea also might be very good. The idea that strikes to the avadhani may be very good, but then he does not wait for that idea to mature in the form of a beautiful verse where everything has fallen into its place, because there is this fear that he might be laughed at by people. So he comes up with a verse along with which he gives lot of explanation, and all that explanation is not, all that material is not present in the verse. It is extraneous to that verse. And I feel it's a way of cheating the audience, telling them that they have composed a verse which has all these in it when it doesn't have. And and I have seen that what happens is, avadhanis usually, when they compose this verse extemporaneously, the audience claps because they have never seen a Sanskrit poem being composed so spontaneously. And avadhanis take to be an appreciation of the verse that they have composed rather than an appreciation of the spontaneity of their verse. And then they keep this avadhana verse as a benchmark for the verse that they compose at home, because they know that if you compose such a verse, the audience will appreciate, the readers will appreciate such a verse. And the verse that they compose at home are also badly sculpted because their benchmark is something which is not up to the mark.
So I think we thank Doctor for this very interesting discussion, and we look forward to talking with him again. And I personally felt that one of the messages I take is the travel which we all have to do between the center and periphery, and sometimes the periphery becomes the center and the center becomes the periphery. because we all are kind of ruled by binaries, and the whole idea of any creative work or any creative experience is to lose the binary and become the binaries at different points, and in that process lose the binary and become the whole. Thank you very much.
Thank you.